Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ladies and gentlemen, may Allah peace and mercy be with you. So it turns out even the way Muslims greet each other is almost the same Jesus did. In the book of John, chapter 20, verse 21, when Jesus approached the disciples, he told them, peace be with you. Today I'm going to start my talk with kind of unique kind of research. Maybe this is the first time you hear about this. Unfortunately, such kind of research has never been told in like school, colleges, or universities, or even never been taught in like a synagogue or like churches or even mosque. So today, I mean, for the last 5-6 years, I've been doing Bible studies with Christians, and I run across some really questions that it's really hard to answer. My answers were almost from the Quran, but the problem I face is like most of the Christian friends, they don't believe in Quran, and neither do the Muhammad. So it's really facing kind of challenge for me to answer them from the Quran because I feel like I'm just wasting my time. Now what I did is I just tried to dive in the Bible and try to find those answers from the Bible. So most of the questions are really common, like why Muslim women wear hijab, or for example, why don't eat pork, why you don't drink, why you're circumcised, why you're a tourist. And some of the questions that are really hard to answer, like how can you prove Muhammad is not a liar from the Bible? And such questions, I dive in the Bible, I found the best I can, and today I'm gonna show you those results I got. Before I get started with the questions, about like 19 questions, my research is gonna be about two parts. The first part is the answer for those questions, and the second part I'm gonna go with the science, because I feel like this is the best way to prove Muhammad is or is not liar, and again from the Bible. Now, only first slide I'm gonna talk about Islam, a little bit what Islam means, that's from Quran. And then the second slides, I'm gonna make a deal with you, like how is it true that Christians believe in the Old Testament or not. And then after this, we're gonna switch gears and we go to the questions and with the science. So first of all, let's talk about Islam. Islam is a word taken from salam, which means peace. Okay, and that's scripture written in the Quran. It says in the book of the Quran, in chapter 68, it says, then we'll make the Muslims like, are we making the Muslims like criminals? What's wrong with you? Malakum kayfa tahkumun? So God here actually, he compares Muslim with criminals. So that's why actually I disagree with people when they say, are we infidels? No, a Muslim actually against criminals. So this actually proves that it's a religion of peace. And the Muhammad said, a true Muslim is he from whom people are safe from tongue and hand. So if you are really true Muslim, you should never harm people with your hand and tongue. So I disagree, to be honest with you. I disagree with Muslims when they teach us from the entire time, if you're really Muslim, if you say there's no God but Allah and Muhammad, Messenger of God. Actually, that's wrong. So the true Islam, is true Muslim, is should follow this. Is ISIS Muslims? For sure not. They are never be Muslims because they kill people. So that's actually make sure that Muslims should follow this. And me personally, honestly speaking, I kind of not following this definition too much, not into this definition too much for two reasons. First, I mean, okay, so Islam is a religion of peace. I mean, are you kidding me? ISIS and Qaeda and shit is happening everywhere. So what is the peace? First, second, I might ask myself, okay, so if Islam promotes peace, does Christianity promote violence? Does Judaism call for extremism? No. So there's nothing unique for Islam if I say Islam promotes peace, right? So we have to be fair. Me, personally, I tend more into the second definition, which is actually everyone agree with me, is like derived from the Aslim, which means surrender or submit. So a definition of Muslim as someone who submit to God. But submit what? Submit his will, submit his house, submit his money. A friend of mine, actually, he's a Christian, when you go to his house, Danyankin, he's sitting here. Actually, he has a sign in his house. He said, this house is owned by the Lord. So it means he's submitting his house to the Lord. So by definition, is Muslim. I know it's sometimes a word Muslim is hard to digest, but I'm just talking about the definition, Arabic definition. So let's see what a Quran agree with me or not. Abraham was neither Jew nor a Christian, but he was a Muslim and he was not the polytheist. So Quran says, Abraham, are you kidding me? Abraham was like 1,000 years before Muhammad. Yes, Abraham was a Muslim because he's submitting his will to God. That's actually what the Quran says. Now, mention when Abraham was raising the foundation of the house in Ishmael, okay, saying, oh Lord, accept this from us. Indeed, you are the hearing, the knowing. Oh Lord, make us Muslim to you and from the descendants Muslim nation. So Abraham was calling to have a nation that's submitting their will to God. Now, we are, again, this is the only slides I'm gonna talk about Quran. I'm gonna switch to Bible next. Were you witness when death approached Jacob in the Mahal Yaqub al-Maut? So he says to his sons, what will you worship after me? Jacob is Israel, and his sons are, you know, Ben Israel, son of Israel. He says, they say, we worship your God and the God of your fathers, Abraham, Ishmael, and Isaac, one God, and we testify that to Muslims. So even sons of Israel, according to Quran, they are Muslims because they are submitting their will to God. Now, Saba, which is kind of Yemen now, queen, so when she came to Solomon, she told him, my lord, indeed I have wronged myself and I become Muslim with Solomon. She was thousands of years before Muhammad, okay? And she became Muslim because she is submitting their will to God. Doesn't mean that she is following Muhammad's religion, but she is submitting to God. And even Jesus, according to Quran, he's also Muslim, for sure, because he's submitting his will to God. So he said, but Jesus, when Jesus felt disbelief from the people and surrounding and disciple, he said, who are my supporters for the sake of Allah? Man ansar Allah. And the disciples said, you are our supporters from Allah. We have believed in Allah. We testify that we are Muslims. Even according to Quran, even disciples, they are Muslims because they are submitting to God. Now, is that true? I mean, let's see what the Bible says. In the book of John, chapter 5, number 30, he says, I can do nothing on my own authority. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So Jesus said, I'm following the own of my God, the will of my God. According to this definition that I just said, Jesus is also Muslim. Again, I said, it's really hard to digest this word nowadays, but it's just definition. Now, now people might ask me, okay, so if this is Islam, what's the Muhammad's message? Okay, so because this Islam has been a long time, so what's Muhammad's message? Actually, Muhammad, he didn't come with Islam. Kind of, this is a wrong idea, what people say. Islam is already there. It's one religion. I'll let you figure out by the end of the talk, it's one religion and one God. Muhammad's only message said, I was only sent to complete the good moral and ethics. That's the only job Muhammad did. He just tried to complete the good morals and ethics. And I'm going to link this with Jesus later. Now, the second one deal I'm going to work with you is we Christians, we don't care about, I'm going to make a law, that's what he told me. So he said, we Christians, we don't care about that much about the Old Testament. Because actually, I'm going to lay the foundation now, because later I'm going to talk 50% of the Old Testament and 50% of the New Testament. So I have to make sure that you guys believe in both old and new before I keep moving. Now, in the book of James, chapter 2, verse, by the way, before I forgot, you don't have to write down anything. Each one has a smaller notes. You can write down your emails, and by the end of the talk, I will grab them, and I will make sure to have the slides, okay? Because it's a lot of talk. Yes, sir. Slow down?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, sure. Yep. So, yeah, thanks for letting me know. So, in the book of James, so I'm trying to tell you that why we have Old Testament and New Testament, and we have to believe in both of them. In the book of John said, if you really fulfill the royal law, which he means actually the commandments, according to the scripture, you should love your neighbors as yourself. You are doing well. So far, so good. But if you show partiality, some of them, you are committing sin and you are convicted by the law as lawbreaker. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in just one point, he's just guilty of all of it. So that's actually clear that Old Testament is as important as the New Testament. In the book of Matthew, chapter 5, he said, don't think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have to come to abolish them, but to fulfill. Exactly as Muhammad says before, I'm not here to come in new religion. I'm just trying to complete the morals. Jesus said, I'm trying here to fulfill. I'm not abolish. As there is Old Testament, as there is the New Testament. Book of Matthew, chapter 5, 17. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter, nor a point, dot, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. All the same secret, Old Testament and New Testament. Now, again, Matthew says, then Jesus says to the crowds and his disciples, the scribes and Pharisees, sit on Moses' seat. So do and observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do, for they preach, but they don't practice. Follow their teaching, but don't follow their practices. They didn't do well, so you should do well, aka follow the Old Testament. After I make this deal with you, I'm going to switch gears to the questions, and then I will go to the science after this. So first, who is Allah, and why Muslims insist on using this word? So first of all, if you go to Wikipedia, he will tell you just definition of Allah. He's great and blah, 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 and unique, and he has guided scripture, signs, and prophets, and the last one is Muhammad. That's what Wikipedia says. The best definition of Allah is mentioned in chapter 112 of the Quran. There are only four verses. Tell you exactly what God is. He says, God is Allah who is one, and he is the eternal refuge, Samad. He is neither begotten nor begotten, nor is there in him to covenant. So there are four verses in this chapter only defines the best way of Allah. So why Muslims insist of using Allah rather than God? God is Allah and Allah is God, right? Why do they insist of using Allah? First of all, if I use God, God could be anyone. God could be Jesus for a Christian, could be idol for Hindus, maybe for cows, okay? But when I say Allah, people know that Allah is a Lord or God for Muslims, right? And also Allah is God, but God could not be Allah, so the arrow could not go back. Second, when I say God, I can say God's. But when I say Allah, I cannot say Allah is single, it cannot be plural. What? The beauty of this word also, when I say God, I say goddess. When I say tiger, I say tigress. But when I say Allah has no male, no female. Also, when I say God, I can say Godfather. There is a movie, if you have seen this before, okay? And also there's Godmother. But I cannot say Allah Father or Allah Mother. So with this now, the question is, okay, so now people insist, Muslims insist on using Allah, but does Jesus believe in Allah? In the book of Matthew, chapter 27, the same repeated in Mark, it says, and at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice when he put on the, you know, put on the cross. We know the story, Friday, Saturday, okay, Sabbath. He say, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Okay, this is, by the way, it's exactly from the book. I'm just copy-paste. And they translated because this is Hebrew. So it says, my God, where have you forsaken me? Let me just put on this, Eli, Eli. So Eli, Eli is a Hebrew. Because Hebrew and Christian Arabic is almost the same, so I'm going to translate this to Arabic and you see. So, Eli, Eli, Elahi, Elahi in Arabic. And Lima in Arabic, is in here, it's Lima also in Arabic. And Sabachthani, like Taraktani. So, look at the similarity between them. So, here actually he's talking about God. He's like, Eli, Eli, Lima, Sabachthani. So, actually, that's kind of really nice to mention. Now, the second question is about Muhammad. Also, so here in the Quran, talk about Jesus, talked about Muhammad in the Quran. But again, forget this because people, they don't believe in Quran, but I'm just mentioning this. He said, mention what Jesus, the son of Mary, said, oh, children of Israel, indeed, I am the messenger of God, Allah, to you, confirming what came before me of the Torah, which is the Old Testament, and bringing good tidings of the messenger to come after me, whose name is Ahmed. So, Ahmed is the other name for Muhammad. So, that's the Quran. But because you don't believe, forget about this. So, yeah. So, Book of Deuteronomy, in the Book of Deuteronomy, it says, this is actually one of the most challenging verses to the Christian, to be honest with you. It's really confusing. Let me put it this way. The Lord says to Moses, what they say is good. Moses is the speaker. What they say is good, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their fellow Israelites, and I will put my words in his mouth. He will tell them everything I command him. I myself will call to account anyone who does not listen to my words that the prophet speaks in my name. Now, this is really confusing. Why? Because the Christian now, if they say Moses talking about the prophet after him, if he's talking about Jesus, Jesus is a prophet. So if he's talking about Muhammad, they have to believe in Muhammad. So this is really confusing verse in the Bible. Now, in the Quran says, Quran says, okay, now people tell me what the difference between Muhammad and Jesus. So Muhammad says, God says in the Quran, says, we have not sent you, talking to Muhammad, but a mercy to the entire humanity. So actually Muhammad's message is from the time he was there till the hereafter. But Jesus, what he says in the book of Matthew, Jesus says, he answered, I was not sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So if you see the difference, like humanity versus only time frame. Okay, so Jesus was only sent, and by the way, so he's talking. I'm only sent to those guys. Another message is God says in the book of Matthew, he says, these 12, he's talking about the disciples, Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles. Gentiles, if you don't know, I mean, we Muslims, Hindu, so anyone not Jewish at that time, then Gentiles. And enter no town, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So even Jesus asking the disciples to go only for those people. Now, but that's kind of weird, because when I read the missionaries, they have always teach us this. Are you kidding me? Because Jesus was sent to the entire humanity. Jesus said that in the book of Mark. He said, go into the whole world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. So before I keep going, there are two conditions and five signs. Two versus five. The two conditions, if you are baptized and you believe, if you baptize and believe, five signs should apply to you. First sign, in my name they will cast out demons. They speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes in their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, they don't die. And they will lay their hands on the sick, they will recover. So if you are really, really Christian, and if you are really following this, and you are baptized and you believe in Jesus, those five signs should apply to you. I know it's kind of risky to have poison, but okay, now let me go to the second quote, five. Do Muslims believe in Jesus? What's Jesus in the Quran? What's Jesus in Islam? So among Quran, to be honest with you, is the only major world religion that believe in Jesus. Neither Jewish nor Hindu nor Christian faith that recognize the person of Jesus. And also Quran, he was mentioned in the Quran in 90 verses and 15 chapters, and include there's a chapter called Mary. If you know that, there's a chapter in the Quran called Mary. So, and FYI, Jesus was mentioned 25 times, while Muhammad only mentioned four. So 25 verses 4 in the Quran. He was called witness, messenger, righteous apostle, God's word, God's spirit, Messiah, and son of God. Okay, so sign of God, according to Muslim, not son of God. That's the difference. Again, so in Islam, corroborates that Jesus was born to a virgin, was sinless, performed miracles, and was superior to the other prophets. Jesus was considered one of the five mightiest prophets in Islam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad. Quran says, and remember, her, she's talking about Mary, who guarded her chastity. We breathed into her our spirit, and we made her and her son a sign for the peoples. Ayat al-Alameen. Now, also the Quran says, the angel said, O Mary, God sends you the good news of command of his. His name shall be Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary. He will be highly honored in this world and the next world, and will be among those favored by God. He will speak to the people alike when in the cradle and when grown up, and he will be among the righteous. Now, also mention that and God will teach him the book and the wisdom and give him the knowledge of the Torah, which is the Old Testament, and the Gospel, which is the New Testament, and appoint him as his messenger to the children of Israel. That's actually exactly, look, children of Israel is matches what Jesus said. Now, the Quran says, indeed, the example of Jesus to Allah is like that of Adam. So what was the analogy between them? He created him from dust, then he said to him, be, and he was. Now, the best description of Jesus was mentioned by first disciple of Muhammad. His name is Ali. He mentioned actually a nice story about Jesus. People told him, what is Jesus? He said, he used rocks as his pillow. He wore rough clothes. He ate stale food. He mixed bread with hunger. He lit his night with moon. He used the long nights of winters to spread his shadow to the east and west. His fruits and herbs were grass eaten by animals. He had no wife to test him, nor child to grieve him, nor wealth to distract him, nor greed to humiliate him. His right was his 2 feet, and his servant was his 2 hands. So that's actually the best definition of Jesus. Now, why Muslims pray this weird? They kind of bow and face down. It's really weird. Why do they do that? And Book of Matthew says, when the disciples hear this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. Even the disciples, they face down the way Muslims pray. In the Book of Matthew, chapter 26, then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little bit further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed. That's Jesus what he did. Okay, my Father, if this is possible, may this cup be taken from me, you not as well, but I will. So also, Jesus did exactly the same. Look at the book of Joshua. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell face down to the ground before the ark of the Lord. Remaining there till evening, the elders of Israel did the same and sprinkled dust to their heads. We have some Shia people back home, actually. They do the same. Sometimes they tear their clothes and they put some dust on. It's kind of old tradition. Book of Numbers say, but Moses and Aaron fell face down. Book of 2 Chronicles, blah, blah, blah. It's a hard name for me. Okay. Jehoshaphat. Anyway. So Book of Genesis, Abraham also fell down. So it's common. It's nothing new for Islam. So everything goes before. Now, I mentioned those. I don't have time for this, but those are the references. Now, after prayer, Muslim also fast in Ramadan. Okay, this year is going to be May 27. In the book of Exodus, the same story mentioned in Matthew's, Moses was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights without eating bread or drinking water. So by the time he wrote the commandments, he was fasting. Book of Luke, they say to him, the disciples of John fast and offer prayers. So fast and prayer, that's exactly what the Muslims do. And so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink. Jesus said, blah, blah, blah. Can you make wedding great? And then the whole story. So the point is they prayed and fast. So after they had fasted and prayed in the book of Acts, they placed their hands to them and set them off. So nothing new. It's old. Everything is old. Now, adultery, I'm not going to waste my time here because it's one of the commandments. We all know about adultery. But there's actually nice words by Jesus. He said in the book of Matthew, you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. Agree. We all agree. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. It's really nice words, okay? Because we all agree on the adultery, but this is really nice words by Jesus. So, is it true that Islam can hands? It happens now in Saudi Arabia. Me personally, I disagree. It's kind of rude, but it's happening. But let's see if it's common or not. In the book of Deuteronomy, if two men are fighting, and the wife of one of them comes to rescue her husband from his assailant, and she reaches out and seizes him private parts, okay, only, you shall cut off her hand, show her no pity. She didn't do anything, she just, okay? Islam allows this only if you are a thief, and me personally, I disagree. Okay, it's old tradition, but in some countries, they stick to it. In the book of Matthew, Old Testament versus New Testament. If your right, this is really nice words by Jesus, if your right eye, causes you to stumble, gouge out and throw away. Okay, it's easy, it's better for you to lose one part of your body than the entire body go to hell. If your right hand causes you to stumble, cut off and throw away. It's easy for you to lose one than the entire body go to hell. So Jesus actually, he kind of like told us, it's common, nothing new, okay? It's already there. Now, drinking, okay? In the book of Ephesians, he said, don't get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but will be instead be filled with spirit. Proverbs, wine is a mocker, and the beer is a proler. Whoever is led astray by them is not wise. So drinking is there before, so nothing new. Now, in the Department of Justice, I'm going to go statistic now and size after this. Department of Justice says they usually drunk people, they misbehave, they use abusive language, they don't know how to talk. Only 1996, every day. There's an average of 2,713 rapes took place mostly by drunk people. The highest percentage of AIDS also among those who are people drunk. I'm going to share the slides later if you want, by the way. So this is the national crime by the Department of Justice. In 2010 only, 30 people die every day from drunk driving, like one death every 48 hour minutes. Unfortunately, 10,000 people killed from drunk driving, 1.4 million arrested DUI, and 82% of fatal crashes are caused by DUI. Now, are Muslim guys circumcised? That's also a question I've been asked before. So in the book of Genesis, chapter 17 says, then God says to Abraham, as four of you, my covenant, blah, 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 every male among you shall be circumcised. Every man of you shall be circumcised. Again, he says, you are undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of your covenant. And he mentioned that's including those born in your household or brought with money from foreigner. Without regard if this is in your community or anybody come to your land, they should be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who has not been circumcised in the flesh will be cut off from the people. He has broken my covenant. Again, if you notice this, by 8 days, Jesus was circumcised. He should apply Abraham rules. And the good thing, he made the deadline. It's like when I do homework. On the 8th day, exactly, okay, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus. And the name of the angel he had given before he was conceived. Exactly the 8th day, Jesus was conceived, was circumcised. So something before. Now, is Islam okay with, I'm not going to talk about LGBT because it's a friendly community. I'm going to take this down. But people ask me about transgendering now. In the book of Deuteronomy says, no one who's emasculated or has his male organ cut off shall enter the assembly of the Lord. And not even this, a little bit go beyond that about even clothes. In the book of Deuteronomy says, a woman shall not wear man's garment, nor shall a man put on woman's clothing. Forever does this things an abomination to the Lord of God, to the Lord your God. Pigs. So the same story mentioned the Leviticus and Deuteronomy. And the pig, because it's part of the hoof and it's cloven-footed, but does not chew the cud. It's unclean to you. You shall not eat any of the flesh, and you shall not touch even the carcasses. Even when die, don't touch them. They are unclean to you. In the book of Isaiah, who sit in graves and spend night in secret places, who eat pig's flesh and broth of unclean meat, is neither the vessels, blah, blah, blah. Now, well, let's say what the science talk about pigs. Why Muslims are so strict not eating pork? Because I know some people, actually, my friends, they drink, Muslim, they don't pray, they don't fast. They do everything, but they don't eat pork, okay, for some reason. They say, okay, pigs are scavengers. That's what the science says, collective evolution, which means that they eat almost everything, including rotten food, feces, urine, carcasses, and even cancerous growths. Says the digestive system of the pig is incapable of removing those accumulated toxins from the body because a pig will digest its food entirely in about only 4 hours. Another story, sweat like a pig, man. You sweat like a pig. Actually, it's kind of wrong story. The science now says true pigs, they don't have sweat glands in their body, and then actually they don't even sweat. So which means that they are unable to remove excessive toxins by sweating like human beings. This means that pork meat would be much more toxic. Now, there's another statistic says in 69 of new pork samples, they had some research on 200 porks. They found 69 of them, almost 70%. This is bacteria can cause fever, gastrointestinal illnesses, diarrhea, vomiting, and crumbs. Okay? Again, this is another statistic. Now, does Quran call for tourism? Are you guys tourists? You guys kill everybody, ISIS, Qaeda, Bin Laden, jihad, extremism, right? So let's see. First of all, we have to make sure that in Islam, it's really clear that anybody can practice any religion. Forget about ISIS for now, okay? Anybody, you don't have to practice any religion. God says there shall be no compulsion acceptance of religion. You don't have to accept religion. People, you can be atheist, okay? The right course has been become clear from the wrong. It's your choice. So that God clear says you don't have to do anything. It's your choice. Now, even when God asked Muhammad to preach people, he asked him, call the way of your Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching. Mu'idhat al-hasanah. Okay, and agree with them in the ways that the best among gracious. So don't be violent. Be nice and gentle with them. That's actually the message. Now, let's talk about jihad. Jihad is really a word that's been asked by 1,000 times. What jihad means? I'm going to shed some lights on this. Jihad actually means to struggle and strive in Arabic. And the best jihad that people do is against your own self. One of the jihad is go to battle, for sure, this is one of the jihad, but the worst is against your own self. Jihad by being vocal action. I guarantee everybody here in this room doing jihad. The mother is doing jihad by raising her kids, because she's struggling, striving to raise them up. And the students are doing jihad by going to school and studying and blah, blah, blah. Okay, and the father is going to work. Maybe people disagree with me. Even US Army, when go to Iraq and free them, this is jihad because they're trying to free the country. Everything doing strive and struggle is called jihad. Now, let's see what Muhammad says. We have just returned from the lesser jihad, which is the battle, and to the greater jihad, which is struggle against the self. So there is a small, there is a big. Big is yourself. Now, and the Quran says, now let's see, I'm going to walk with you to the sequence of the jihad in Islam. First, Islam says, Quran says, only fight in the way of Allah those who fight you but don't assault. وَلَا تَعْتَدِينَ اللَّهِ يَحْبِ الْمُعْتَدِينَ So he said, indeed Allah does not like assaulters. If you got hit, hit back. That's it, self-defense. Don't start war. Again, neither kill others. He says, so whoever has assaulted you, then assault them in the same way they assault you. Don't cross the line. First, self-defense. If you get hit, hit back. Now, and if they seek peace, then seek peace and rely upon Allah. If there's truce, go for it. And don't commit abuse, just in case if there's, now, that's what I call God's ROE, rules of engagement. When you go to war, it says, don't commit abuse in the earth, spreading corruption. That of the Ardham of Sidin. So he said, keep in mind, don't cross the line, okay? There's some rules. Now, also said, we decreed upon the children, this is the most beautiful, in my opinion, the most beautiful verse in the Quran. And unfortunately, nobody applies it. It says, we decreed upon the children of Israel, whoever kills a soul is like killing the whole humanity. And if you save a soul, it's like saving the whole humanity. And by the way, Quran said a soul, doesn't say a Muslim or Christian. So anybody, kill anybody for no reason, is trifling. Now, I'm not going to talk about Muhammad's rules of engagement. He also says, don't kill, don't practice, don't rob, don't kill monks. Don't. I'm going to share with this later, okay? So was Islam spread by sword? A lot of people ask me. I disagree with some Muslims, actually, because, okay, let me put it this way. I'll be honest with you. So in Islam, you know, we have Shia and Sunni people. So Sunni people, they always say no. Islam was not spread by war, by sword. And they justify why. The Shia people say, yes, this is history, you cannot deny. And they give you reasons why they justify it. Me personally, after I did research, I disagree with both of them. Islam was yes and no. So it was spread by sword sometimes, and was not sometimes. So yes and no, we have to be neutral. So those are Muslim countries, okay? Indonesia is the highest one, is the biggest Islamic country. Middle East, south of Soviet Union, east coast of Africa and North Africa, including Turkey, which is kind of between Middle East and Europe. Now, in Spain, we know Muslim conquered Spain. I mean, it's history, you cannot deny. But also, the history said they didn't force people to convert. And BBC, which I trust, I don't trust Arabic writers sometimes, says one reason for the rapid Muslim success was the generous surrender terms they offered by people. Okay, which contrasted with the harsh condition imposed by previous. So Muslims actually gave some good offers, so that's why people accept Islam that time. The Muslim period in Spain is often described as the golden age of learning, where libraries, colleges, public baths, and established literature. So what actually was really good time by that time. I know they conquered, but so it says non-Muslims in Spain, non-Muslim, they were not forced to live in ghettos, they were not slave, they were not prevented from lowering their faith, they were not forced to convert to Islam, they are not. Even the Jewish and Christian were able to contribute to society. So that's Spain. Now let's go to India. India, we know, Muslims conquered India, or not conquered, maybe I don't know how to say this, but ruled India for 1,000 years. And now 80% of populations are non-Muslims. If you're really using sword, all of them should be Muslims. And in India, actually, what it says Muslim arrived Islam there by merchants and traders become the carriers of Islam, propagated whatever they want. So those merchants, because they went to the southeast of Asia, they propagate Islam whenever they go. Malaysia and Indonesia, the biggest Islamic country in the world, there is no single soldier go there. I'm not defending on them, but this is the history. Now, Africa, I want to be honest with you, why people cares about East coast of Africa. There's nothing there, right? So there's no point, no oil, nothing. at least maybe they go to, if they go actually to Spain, at least there are maybe some resources, some white girls. Anyway, so Islam. So from 1934 to 1984, this is the period of time, 50 years, Islam was increased by 235 and Christianity by 47. Even sometimes kind of Muslims, kind of biased, to be honest with you. They told, hey, because people joined Islam. I agree, but keep in mind also Muslims, they have a lot of kids. So it's not like Christian, right? If you guys have two or three, Muslims have eight, nine. In the book of Luke, chapter 12, say, but okay, again, so this is Islam. Agree with you that Islam was spread. But who said Christianity was not? I mean, we have to be honest. Unfortunately, it was. Jesus said in the book of Luke, but as of these enemies of mine, who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. I know this is kind of weird because Jesus was merciful, but sometimes force used to promote peace, to promote religion. Unfortunately, the religion of Europe, we all know about this, right? So in Holy Roman Empire, there are between 3 and 11 million people killed between Protestant and Catholic, unfortunately. We are sad for this, by the way. In France, about 2 to 4 million. In Great Britain and Ireland, between about 500,000 people killed. Okay, so, I mean, it's common, so nothing new. Till here and after this, we want the same track. And then we're going to part ways on the signs. Why Muslim wear hijab? Is it subjugation for her? She's a beautiful woman, by the way. I try to pick the best. I always tell my friends, whenever you Google Mary, you will never see Mary without hijab. You will never Google and see. She always wearing this. Oh, maybe because it's hot over there. Oh, maybe it's because it's cold. Are you kidding me? Now it's hot. Now it's global warming. In the book of Timothy, I want women to adorn themselves in respectable apparel, with sobriety and shamefacedness and modesty, not with elaborate hairstyles and gold or costly attire. So this kind of shamefacedness. Now, again, book of Corinthians, it says, every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head, since it is the same as if her head was shaven. For its woman will not cover her head, then she should cut her hair off. But since it's kind of weird, disgraceful for her to cut off, then let her cover her head. So covering head is something old. There's nothing new for Islam. And the Quran said, now we have to believe, we have to know why Islam promoted this. Why? Say to those believing women, they should lower their, okay, by the way, so before I go this, I want to just focus on hijab. FYI, hijab was imposed to men before women. For men, for me as a Muslim, I have two hijab, and for women has three. Okay? So hijab imposed on men before women. For men, they have two conditions. First, so as to the believing men, they should lower their gaze, يغضوا أبصارهم, and guard their private parts. So mine, hijab, this and this. Okay, that will make the greater purity for them. So the men, by the way, look at the verse 30, the next one, 31. The next one, so hijab imposed on men before women. Woman says, so believing women, they should lower their gaze like men, they should guard their private parts, and they should display their beauty and ornaments except blah, blah, blah for their. More details mentioned here. Oh, Prophet, he's talking about Muhammad. He says, tell their wives and daughters and the believing women that they should cast their outer garment over the persons when abroad. That's most convenient. And should not be known as and not be a molest. So actually, Islam put this as not be molested. Okay, so hijab prevents harassment, abuse, and molestation. That's the job of hijab. Now let's talk about the signs. Statistics. Department of Justice says every 9-8 seconds an American is sexually assaulted. It says on average there are 3,221 okay, victims between those ages are sexually assaulted. Okay, 1988, an estimated 17.7 million American women has been victims for attempted or completed rape. So hijab actually was put to secure the woman rather than anything else. Most of the most of the things happened between that age. And out of every six American women, only America, by the way, has been victim of attempted or killed. But now people maybe ask me, because I have to be honest, I mean, is that not only for Africa? Because if you go to Egypt, even Islamic country, but the sexual assault is really high. We have to be honest. That doesn't mean that Islam is wrong, but people are wrong. If you give me Lamborghini, I can drive it, I'm pretty sure you will be die when I drive because I'm a bad driver. But if you drive, I'm pretty sure you will drive me safe. Doesn't mean that Lamborghini is a bad car, okay? Mean that I'm bad. So not Islam actually, but the people in Egypt, for example, they have their, anyway, but you know what I mean. So it's not about the people who apply the it's not about the Islam itself. Now, if you talk about subjugation, I'm going to tell you about what the history says. In Babylon, it says the women were degraded and were denied the rights. If man murdered a woman, instead of killing the man, he can kill his wife. The Babylonian history. Now, Roman are really, the man has a right to kill his wife. In Egyptian, the woman was described as a devil and a science of evil. Okay? Pre-Islam, Quran says about it, whenever they have a baby female, they bury it while she's alive. So in Islam, before Islam and everything before the history, the women were really degraded. So Islam actually was not degrading the woman for wearing hijab, but actually just like to protect her, that's it. So hijab does not degrade, but uplifts the woman and protects her modesty and chastity. And if you talk about hijab, actually, there are many, many hijabs. As I said, that a hijab should be hijab of intention, hijab the way person walks, talks, behaves, and treats people. Now, the last one, before I go to the science, is polygamy. Now, let's see why God, you Muslims, you get married to four wives? Is it true? I mean, some people ask me, I'm kind of weird because I can barely handle one. How can you handle four? That's too much. I've been asked this question too much. Let me ask. God says there is a reason behind why we have four. Even I don't have money for do this. Says if you fear that you will not deal justly with the orphan guilt, then marry those that please you. Two, three, four. But if you fear that you will not be just, then marry only one. I've read some articles says Islam is the only religion among all religions that say marry only one. Okay? But that is more suitable that you may not be inclined to justice. Because you know, sometimes if I have two, I might be in love with some of them more than the other. If you can't do that, if you can't handle yourself, don't do that. Only one is enough. But there are some cases it's really more helpful to have another one. I'm going to tell you this. Now let's see what the book of Genesis. So nothing new, it's already there. Genesis says Sarai, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children. She was infertile, Sarah. So what she did is, maybe she was scared that Abraham going to divorce her, okay? So she had a female Egyptian servant. His name is Hagar. So she told Abraham, hey, this is Hagar, and gave her Abraham, her was a wife. So Abraham has two, so nothing new. Let's take, okay, Genesis says Abraham took another wife. His name is Keturah. So Abraham has three. Okay, so far so good. Now let's go to the Solomon. Solomon has 700 wives and 300 concubines. He has 1,000. If he's 1,000 years old, it means that he has wife every day. Lucky he. Anyway, in the book of Chronicles, it says, and Shalala begets sons of the country of Moab after, so Hashem and his wives. So polygamy is something old. Look at the book of David. David has 18 wives. I don't have time to mention them. Those are names, some of them. Those are references. 18. So polygamy is something old, not before Islam. Let's talk about Jacob. Jacob, we saw user C for people. He has Leah, Rahil, Bilha, and Zilpah. Okay, he has four. And Judaism, they're also there. I mean, people, if you read the history, the practice of polygamy continued until Rabbi bin Yehuda, at this time, issued an edict against it. The Jewish community is living in Muslim. I've seen Jewish actually back home back in 1950s. They have two or three. If you ask people in the Middle East, they will tell you. Continue the practice until 50. An act of the chief rabbinate of Israel extended the ban. So it's more political than historical. Hinduism are the most more polygamous than Muslims. The history says the percentage of polygamous in this year's 10 years was 5.6 comparing to those Muslims. But it was only 1945, last century, when the Hindu Marriage Act was passed in India, it becomes illegal for Hindu. So again, more political than, so, okay? So we all agree with me. Now, Hinduism, I don't know about Buddhism, but again, Hinduism, Judaism, and Islam, and Christianity, all of them, they have the same, so nothing new. Now, let's see what's the reasons behind this. For sure, they have reasons for this. First of all, Islamic was a brand new religion and need more people to follow, so they have more kids. More workforce, more manpower were needed, farming, warfare, right? A man, that's the way I put it, a woman is not factory. Okay, if I have 12, I cannot ask her to have more. Islam found a solution for the infertile woman. Now, Abraham, instead of divorcing his wife, he can get another one, right? And men, menopause, senilias, goes to 70s for men, which is good news, but for women, it's 51. That's what the medicine says. Now, number six, women are more emotional than men. Look at this, by the way. Jordan Gray is number one publisher on Amazon. Jordan Gray says, women are more emotional than men. Women needs be loved, safe, seen. Those guys are you married, make sure. Appreciated, feel like she can count on you, be allowed to be returning, and feel sexual desire. How can a woman get all of those if she has no husband? Correct? Now, how about students abroad, like me, 2-3 years back over here? How about troops being deployed? How about people travel a lot, businessmen and others? How can you find this? Now, a lot of research done on married guys, they cheat their wives. They said that they are actually sexually active, which is not bad. I mean, people have testosterone high, men. And all their wives are on period or pregnant, so they cheat. Instead of cheating, let them get another wife. So what? Okay, female population has always outnumbered the males historically. There is a story actually here, I'm not gonna go with. They went back to this time, and they say by this time, in the Mesopotamian Iraq, they say that at that time, by genes, those historians, they alive, there are 15 men and 26 men, women at that time. Now, people say, okay, are you kidding me? Now, population says there are 107 boys for each 100 worldwide. Agree. But there's a cheating behind this. There's something. Consider gender size in China and India, especially India. I've talked with Indian guys. India was very, very famous in gender size. When they know it's female, pop, go to hell, okay? They only need male. So if this is without gender size or self-selected abortion, believe me, this number will be around maybe 150. I'm maybe exaggerating, but a little bit less. Let's say, boys, why this is big number? Boys are biologically weaker and more susceptible to diseases than permanent death. I talked to some doctors in the UISC, they agree with me. Actually, they have some statistics about this. Adult males tend to have higher death than females, okay? Why? Because they have some attacks, cancers, strokes, pesticides, environment. I mean, you agree with me because men are more into, you know, more environment than female, so they die more. And also, they have more alcoholism, drug addiction, accidents, homicide, prison inmates and warfare. You know what? So in USA, only 2006, they said there are 3-6 times more men, okay, likely to be a victim of science, and 2.535 times for women. It means that more men will be killed, more women still alive. That's good news for you ladies. 2003, when I was back home, at that time, Operation Iraqi Freedom, US Army made statistics. How many females killed, how many males? It says that among those, there are 94 only females. So the percentage is 97% are males, and only 2.4 females killed. More men killed, less women. 1.7% of the 39 of the US population are identified as gay. I'm not homophobic, but I'm telling you that about 50 million guys are gays, so it means that 50 women will be left unmarried. Agree? So there are more gays, it means more unmarried women. Now, the average lifespan of female is more than that of male. women usually older. And at any given time, one can find there are more widows than widowers. Let's go to that. So this is statistics. It says only this country, Saudi Arabia, okay, they have more men than women. If you see Russia, they are, have more less male. US, blah, blah, blah. So all the world, except for those Islamic countries, for some reason, we have, I mean, more male. But for most of the world, actually, more female. Let's do statistics. In US, we have 7.8 million more female than male. It's mean 7.8 million females without husbands, plus maybe 50 because of gay. So that's going to be around 50. Who cares about those women, 58? So, right? So those would be ended without any husband. In UK, there's 4 million. In, I forgot, maybe Germany, 5 million. And in Russia, there's 9 million. There's 9 million more females than males. Now, that's the questions I've been asked so far. So far, we almost on the same page, same track, right? Everything, the 17 questions I've been asked, I got you the question from the statistics and the Quran, the Bible. Now the question is, the last question is, how can you prove Muhammad is not a liar? And again, from the Bible, because I don't believe in Quran. The good news is, I found it's really hard to answer this question. How can you prove Muhammad is not a liar? How can I prove it, man? It's really hard. How can I prove it? And as you guys believe in spirit of truth, I also have my own spirit of truth. I was like, okay, God, help me on this. It's a really hard question. How can I believe it? And now I believe that the only way to prove this is to compare the science and the both religions. Now, if Muhammad is really a liar, because one of my friends, actually, he's really honest with me. Because to be honest with you, whenever I go Bible studies, I tell people, hey, feel free to criticize Islam. What's your misconception? I'm not here to defend. I'm not to criticize. It's not my job. I'm an engineer. But tell me what's wrong with your belief so I can try to connect the dots. He believes, one of them, actually, he did major in history, Islamic law, Arabic, so he knows more about culture. He said, I think Muhammad's a liar, but he's smart. I was like, okay, how is that possible? He said, because Muhammad, what he did, he found that people are really ignorant, stupid at that time. He take the Bible, change it, rock and roll, we got a new book, and we reign on them. And he did a good job. Now he has 1.7 billion followers, and Islamic is increasing for some reason. So he did a good job, but I don't believe in him, and I don't believe in his book. So I was like, okay, that's fine. Let me tell about the science. I will talk about the science in the book, Bible. I'm going to talk about the science about the book in the Quran. And if he's really a liar, he should copy-paste. Okay? But if he's not, if there's something wrong in the Bible, he should correct it. Or at least delete it if he doesn't like it. Okay? Or he maybe come up with something new. But the good thing is, you guys don't believe in Quran. I believe in Bible. I have to. That's my religion. I have to believe in Jesus. But we all agree on Einstein. We all agree on Steve Jobs, right? We all agree on the scientists. There's no dispute on this. So now I'm going to talk about the science. I'm going to switch gears. Maybe 30 minutes more will be done. The topics will be really interesting now. It's everything on science. Now, before, first one is universe, because the Genesis talk about universe, I would like to start from Genesis again. Big Bang, okay? We all know about Big Bang. Let's see what the Big Bang says about the books. So in the Quran says, have those who disbelieved not considered that the heavens and the earth were a joint entity. And we separated them apart and made from water every living thing. Big Bang is mentioned here. Then what they believe? Now, let's see what the science says about Big Bang. The science says about 13.7 billion years ago, all the universe was concentrated into a single tiny point, and then made the stars and galaxies. The universe becomes hot, blah, 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 and atoms form structure. It's called singularity. So it used to be, by the way, it used to be theory of Big Bang. Now it's a fact. We all agree. No? It's a fact of Big Bang. You all agree on it. It's not?
No.
So, but Islam actually agree with this. Big Bang is, it's a theory.
That's all.
I mean, people, but now try to make it as a fact, actually. I read some research on it. It says fact, it says theory, it says hypothesis, but people try make it fact now. No? Again, let's take it as a theory. Let's agree on the theory, okay? Because this is really challenging, again. Let's make it as a theory, but again, Quran says, agrees with the theory. So far, so good. I mean, let's agree theory, okay? I have some, actually, I read some of this on the fact, and now people are saying it's a fact, but again, let's assume it's a theory. So now let's talk about the sun. The sun, says the Quran, and the sun runs, of course, for a period, وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي مُسْتَقَرٍ لَهَا, determined for it. That is the termination of the exalted and mighty. So here says, the sun runs for a period determined for it. The sun is moving. And it says, لَالشَّمْسُ يَنْبَغِي لَهَا تُدْرِكَ الْقَمَرُ وَاللَّيْ سَابِقًا. It's not allowed for the sun to catch up the moon, nor does the night outstrip the day. But each is swimming along its own orbit. So here, actually, God says the sun is moving around the orbit. Now, again, the Quran says, and he who has created the night and the day, and the sun and the moon, and all heavenly bodies in orbits are kullin fi falakin yasbahun. So here, actually, Quran mentioned that those are swimming. There's orbits that are moving around. Now, let's talk about the signs. The science actually agrees, okay? So Copernicus in 1515 believed the Earth and other planets moved around the sun. And then Galileo came over, and he made a telescope and proved his theory of seeing four moons orbiting Jupiter. So which means that there's nothing, everything is orbiting around the Earth. Now, actually, also the science tell us that it's not for those guys give the credit, but it's also Kepler who discovered and demonstrated that the Earth orbits the sun. So far, actually, that's agree with the science. Let's talk about the earth. God says he created the heavens and the earth in truth. He wraps the night over the day, and he wraps the day over the night. And he subjected the sun and the moon running for a space time. You cover the layl and nahar. So here, actually, this is a really nice story, because here the word wraps in Arabic is taken from the ball. But I don't know how to translate this Arabic in the world. It's kind of like when you say friend, befriend. Ball, I cannot say in ball or ballen, but actually it's taken from the ball. So it's me actually here, it's me taking that the earth is spherical, it's kind of rotating, so there's a day and there's a night. And then after that, he spread the earth. The earth is spread, actually it's taken from the word dahu. Dahu in Arabic, when I did some research on it, dahu, it's one of the, says it's taken from the ostrich egg. And actually now the science agree, because ostrich egg is not spherical, it's kind of more, has one of the others, like radius is not spherical. And actually that agrees. The Quran also said two times that then do not see that we set upon the land, reducing it from the outlying borders. Islam actually agree that the size, I mean the both sides are not equal. If you really look at the science, it says, now, the equatorial diameter and the polar diameter, there is about 42 kilometers difference. So if you see, actually, there are more, is not actually 100% like a circle. Science agree with me that there are like 42. So actually, Quran says that. Now, after this, also, there's one more thing before I go to the Old Testament. It says, it is Allah who has created seven heavens and of the earth, and lack of them. So here, in the book of Genesis, it's talk about seven heavens, but I'm not sure, maybe someone correct me, I'm not sure if the Bible talk about seven layers in the earth. I'm not sure, to be honest. But here, Quran says about seven layers on the earth. And actually, that's what if you see, the science is talking about seven layers of the earth. So I'm gonna talk about moon, and then I will switch to the Bible for those three. The moon says, do you not consider Allah has created seven heavens and layers and made the moon their nur? Nur could be a reflective light, okay? Or could be nur, just a light. But he may says nur and made the sun as a burning lamp, siraj and wahajan. He said, so the difference between them, he said like a sun as a light itself, it's a burning lamp source, but he counted this as a nur, which is kind of reflective. So kind of like they give us a hint that sun and moon are not the same. One is reflective, one is own source. Again, the Quran says, blessed is he who has placed in the sky great stars and placed there a burning lamp and luminous moon, قمر منيرًا. So it means that the moon is not its own source. The moon is reflecting from the sun. Now, the last one, I think. Okay, so one of the things actually Muslims believe, Christian, they don't believe. Even Muslims, actually, they are kind of doubted about this, honestly. But I just want to bring this up. In the Quran, in the chapter of moon, it says, the hour of judgment is coming near, and the moon split to two. But if they see a sign, they turn away, and this is magic. So how about this? This is a story about people come to Muhammad, and kind of they ask for a miracle. And Muhammad showed them to the moon, and he told them this is going to be split to two. And they saw this, but they disbelieve him. And he told them, how about this? Wait for the guys coming from Syria, from Arab region, so because they are a convoy. If they saw it on their way here, ask them. If they saw it, it's true. If not, I'm a liar. And actually, they asked him, and they made sure it's correct. So this is actually one of the book. It says, Veil Muhammad showed them those people that the moon was. So and NASA says, Apollo mission photographs of the RIMA revealed about 300 kilometers long rift on the surface of the moon. No current, but actually they agree. We saw this, but we don't have any scientific evidence that the moon was split to two or more parts and they are reassembled. And actually that's the picture they have. They say, okay, we saw it split, but so far we don't have any scientific proof on this. Now, now I'm gonna shift to the Bible. Now we have three, earth, signs, and moon. I'm gonna shift to the Bible, let's see what they say. Now, the Bible says, it's actually this website, Japanese website, it says when Galileo proved his findings, he was declared heretic by the cardinals of Rome. This was because Catholic teachings were based on the idea that the earth was the center of the universe. We all agree. I mean, actually, for Catholic for a long, long time, they believed the earth was the center. Threatened by torture, Galileo was forced to deny the earth moves and the sun was the center. The Catholic Church did not take back this sentence until 1992. Okay? So for a long time, people believed that it was the center. Now, let's say what the Hebrew and Psalm says about sun, earth, and moon. I'm going to compare this. You, Lord, lay the foundation of the earth at the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. So here, the Bible says the earth will perish. Agree. I mean, according to Quran agree with this. Kullu min alayha fan, so everything will perish. So this is fine. But the problem is, in those two books, it says a generation goes, a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. And he built his sanctuary like the high heavens, like the earth, which has founded forever. So this is, here it says, he says the earth will perish, but here it says the earth will be forever. Now, let's see about the first Samuel. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit seat of honor. For the pillars of earth are the Lord's. And one of them, he has said the Lord's. So here says pillars of the earth. And the sign says there is no pillars of the earth. Now, in the book of Job, he says, he who shake the earth out of the spaces and he put pillars. Again, the same message. Pillars, the earth has pillars. Again, the same in the book of Psalms. Now, in the book of Matthew and Luke, this is the New Testament, it says the devil took him to every high mountain. Be careful with this. Every high mountain and showed him the kingdom of the world and the entire glory. So if I am in the mountain, if I want to see the entire thing, it has to be flat because I cannot see over here if it's rotating, right? So the earth should be flat in order to this be satisfied. But I have to be honest with you, flat, but also the Bible says it's circle. In the book of Isaiah said, it is he who sits above the circle of the earth and it happens like a grasshopper. But again, that's actually not contradiction because this is the circles. I'm an engineer. This is the circle. It's also flat. But the spherical is not. Okay? So the Bible says it's flat and it's circle. And the Lord reigns, the Rab the Majesty, the Lord is Rab, blah, blah, blah. Yet the world is established, shall never be moved. Shall never be moved. So it means that the earth should never be moved. Earth is motionless. Again, the message says in the book of Chronicles, the world established and should never be moved. This Chronicles, this is Psalms. Now, book of Gen- now before us this, now if you see the difference, earth is moving, earth is spherical, here earth is motionless, and earth is flat. So two contradictions between Islam and Christianity and the Bible. Now let's see. We all know Genesis. When you open the book, Genesis, the first, they talk about universe. Look at the Genesis. I'm going to talk about 3, 1 to 19. That's the first one you open the Bible. You will see. God called the light day, and the darkness he called them night. Sweet. And there was evening and there was morning. That's the first day. Okay? And then he says, and God made the two great lights, the light of the day and the lesser light of the night, okay, which is sun and moon. And the stars, and there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. I'm going to ask a question. The sun and light, the sun and moon on the fourth day, and light and day at the first day. How can you have light and day without having sun and moon? Is it a legit question? It's a question, right? So I don't have first day, I have light and dark, and I don't have, how can I have light and day without having sun and moon? In the book of Genesis again, in the first day have light and sun, but on the third day, God called the dry land earth and the waters, blah, blah, blah. This is the third day. Again, the first day I have light and I have earth on the third day. How can I have a light and day without having earth? Because the earth should be moving so I can have day and light. Now, Genesis, and God said, let the earth sprout vegetations, plants, seeds, fruit. This is the third day. And the fourth day, he created the lights and moon. But my question is, how can the vegetation survive without having sun? Because they are considering sun, right? This is scientific. So how can
One
I
have... It's pretty easy.
What's that?
One day is pretty easy.
It's very easy, but for mathematician, it's not. I agree with you, one day. I can take the plant and take it home. I've been asked this question. One day is not easy, but actually this should be other way. Exactly when I say one time, like night and day and night, it's like when I say moon and, you know, if you see the next one, the first one, third and first is again 2 days. I agree with you, with the plants, if you take it home for one day, I've been asked this question.
2 days,
3 days, 4 days, maybe even 5 days. They can survive. Even they can survive without water. But scientific point of view is not legit. They disagree with this. So, okay, I mean, have one difference. I mean, they should, I mean, if it's opposite, actually, I agree with you. Have sun and light and then have vegetation. I agree one day, I mean, I've been asked this question. There is not difference. But actually, I mean, for the point of view, it does. Again, like with those two. You agree with me on those two? Light and first one? I mean, it's scientific.
God is light, and so there would have been light whether there was sun yet or not.
How can you have, sorry, say it again?
God is light.
Okay.
So there was light whether the sun was there yet or not.
You're talking about which one? Just tell me. You're talking in general?
Pardon?
You're talking in general or in specific one?
Either way.
I mean, either way. Okay, so let's take step by step. Okay, let's talk about this. So here we have day and we have night, first day. But here we have, which one is talking about? And God made it. Okay, so let's talk about this one. We have earth. How can you have earth and the third day and you have night shift? This is a scientific question. How can you have night and day without having earth? And God is sources of light.
God is God and we're not.
Yeah, but how can you have right day and night? So it's mean God giving half of them. How can you have, so we now, science says, the earth is moving, we have night, half of them across the sun, half of them not the sun. So how can you have it? Agree, God's God, we all agree.
Yeah. The first one doesn't say that there's sunlight, it just says there's light.
There's light, but this is, no, so it says great, no, it says the greater, God called light day and the darkness he called night. So there's light and there is night and there's light. So that's actually, he called, there was evening and there was morning. So this is coming from the sun or light, right?
Doesn't say it is.
How it comes, I mean.
It says that there's day, that there's light and dark.
So what does the science say about day and light now?
Science wasn't there at creation.
But again, agree. But this is the Bible.
I know.
Right? Yeah, I mean, that's my question. So there's kind of in between.
Okay. And not quite as sure as you were saying.
So I'm saying, because I'm trying to answer the questions I'm trying to answer the questions, how can you prove Muhammad's liar? And so far, all the scientific I'm going to mention now is how can you prove him that he's not liar? So in my point of view, there is kind of contradiction between this and this, scientifically, because I'm talking about science now. Yep. Just move on?
Yeah.
Okay.
If that's what you're trying to prove, just keep moving.
Yep, just keep moving. Because actually, let me have just like maybe 15 minutes. Let's talk to the sky. I'm going to answer maybe this question one by one. It's fine. Let's talk about the sky. Because I have like about maybe 15 minutes, I will end up this. God says we have made the sky, heaven. Again, the sky could be heaven, could be firmament. A well-guarded canopy. I'm going to maybe go like a little bit faster here. It says the atmosphere is an ocean of gas surrounding the world. This was science says. Gases nearly 1,000 thick and harder than stone. So now it says actually, the good thing with this verse is, if you go back, it says we have made the sky a well-guarded canopy. Now, God actually says, now try put the science, what does he mean by this? It says, okay, so first of all, we agree that the atmosphere around the earth, it protects from the millions of meteors falling every day. And now if you see this, actually that's what happened every day. People now saw the moon, that meteors hit the moon, but they don't hit the earth because of this guarded canopy that God says. Also, this is one of the moons of the Saturn. It's like a kind of mashed potato. Second, science also agree that it protects the earth from harmful rays of the sun. The ozone layer absorbs the ultraviolet. And actually, that's what the science says now. And also protects the earth from freezing cold of the space. And, you know, Van Allen belts, which is all known about the magnetic field. So actually, God says in small, free, short terms that there's a well-guarded canopy around the earth. Now, let's say what the book of Job actually words this nicely. Okay, it says about, for he draws up the drops of water, distills the missing rain, skies pour down and drop the money. This is a kind of water cycle. He's talking about this really nicely. Vapor, go back, rain, go back. And also in the book of Amos, mentioned again, it's really nice worded in the Bible, but in Quran actually it mentioned the same stories about more than 20 times. But there is one verse actually is really nice. It says, God, he swears with the firmament with the capacity of returns. I mean, other than those, there is one thing it says about the capacity of returns, that the heaven has capacity of return. So what it says is like, okay, so if you see the signs agree because we have some layers that return water, some of the return the radiation, the electromagnetic waves, and some more.
Can you explain what capacity of return?
What's that?
Can you explain what capacity of return?
Capacity, okay, so Quran says, well, in Arabic it says, وَسَّمَادَةُ الرَّجَى. So this is a translation, but actually what it says is the سَمَادَةُ الرَّجَى, the sky has the capability of return. But if you see the verses before, all those verses, it talk about returning water, you know what I mean? It's like almost the same of the Bible. But this verse, it says of returns. And now the people try to discover what returns he mean, returns of, for example, those. And another story says, when the sky is split open and becomes rose like melted oil. What do they think it done? So now the people try to figure out what he means by rose the sky, and now people figure out, like the nebula, actually, Nebula is an cloud of dust and hydrogen and helium. Arzenite gas originally was a name for diffuse and blah, blah, blah. So actually, even this, it was mentioned in the Quran. So the other way is about expansion. It's also mentioned in the Genesis, expansion of water and expansion of air. It's mentioned well in the Genesis. It says, we constructed the firmament with the strength of skill, and we are expanding. So here talk about the expansion of the universe. The science agree, Friedman, the Russian mathematician, if you heard about this in 1902, introduced the idea of expanding the universe that contained moving matters, the moving matter. Belgium actually would later independently reach the same conclusion. So the earth of expansion, the expansion of the universe actually is well-known scientific thing. In the Quran, they say he created the heaven without pillars that you see. He created the heaven without pillars, and we agree. Now heaven has no pillars. But if you read the Bible, now there's disagreement between both. The Job says the pillars of heaven tremble. And again, So that's one of the differences, actually. And then I will go to the clouds, try to just move a little bit faster so I can finish up. In the clouds, he says, he has sent the winds of glide before mercy. He has heavy laden rain clouds. And also the Quran, same message God. So that's actually, I'm more into this because the science tell us it used to be believed that the clouds are fluffy and light. This is for a long time, it's been thought like this. Look at Professor Todd Lane in School of Science, of Earth Science. He says, although most of the clouds look light and fluffy, they are in fact highly turbulent with very strong air currents. With them, a lot of water. Peggy Limon, she's a researcher at the National Center, what she said in her blog, she says total water content of the cloud is about 500 million grams of water. It's about 1.1 million pounds. That could weigh about as much as 100 elephants. Okay? So each cloud has 100 elephants. And if you are a Democrat and you are feeling partisan, she said, okay? So that could be substitute 2,500 donkeys or 33 dinosaurs. So it means that each cloud has 33 dinosaurs. And actually now it's proven now that it's not fluffy and light, it's really heavy. Food. And the Quran says, oh, believers, eat from the best things which can be provided for you and be grateful to Allah, it should be worshipped. God, كُلُمْ نَطَيِّبَاتِ. He says, only choose the best. Also mentioned again, he says, who causes gardens to grow, trellis and untrellis, palm trees, cause different kind of food, olives, pomegranates, zaytun, rumman, similar, not similar. Eat of each food's fruit would seal them and gives the cow, which is almsgiving. So God here actually asks us to pick the best of the food. Don't jump to any food. Look how the book of Genesis says, and God says, behold, I have given you every plant yielding that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with the seed of food. They shall have them for food. Now it says every plant and every tree. So, oceans. God says he released the two seas meeting side by side. Between them is a barrier. بَيْنَهُمَا بَرْزَقْ لَعِبْغِيَانِ. So neither will transgress each other. And he was released, also is another one. He's also, there's a barrier partition that's forbidden to be passed. Now, the science agrees with that. This, I read this guy, which is a French naval officer, explorer, and scientist, a researcher who studied blah, blah, blah. He said, I'm not going to mention a lot of his, but he said he did some studies. Okay, there are some barriers of different masses of the sea from each other. As a result, he saw that the Mediterranean Sea was particular nature level of salinity and density. At the same time, there are specific life forms. And also he mentioned when he took some samples, okay, he said that's supposed to be equal, but actually they are not. And when he did another one, they said like those partition of those oceans, they have different structures, even in places where they cover closely. So there was a great water curtain in the merging point. Quran says exactly those, actually there's a barrier between the two seas, exactly now with the science agrees. The same kind of water barrier was formulated by the German scientist between the Gulf of Aden and Red Sea. Okay, I'm not gonna mention this. You couldn't buy. So here's the chemistry. Quran says nothing is absent from him. It's actually a nice, really word, verse. It says nothing is absent, even as much as tiny as the atom weight within the heavens or the earth, which is smaller or greater. Everything is written in a clear book. So God's justice will be as much as the atom weight. That's how God is just. Again, the same message is repeated on this. Now, Quran actually defined three words that I'm going to describe now. He says, and whoever does righteous deeds, male or female, while being believer, these will enter the paradise and injustice. And injustice is not done to them, even as much as nakir. I'm going to mention those words in Arabic. So it's me that God is as just as nakir. I'm going to mention this. Have you not seen those who claim themselves, blah, blah, blah? Allah purifies people, and injustice is not done to them, even as much as fatigue or threat. I'm going to mention this. That is Allah, your Lord, to him belongs, blah, 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 and for him, do not poses as much katmir. So those are actually three words, katmir and fear. I'm going to mention this. I'm pretty sure you guys know the palm tree. It's a really famous the Middle East or hot countries like California, for example, they have it. So they have like this small dot, they call it katmir, and this is thread, and this is called fatil. So this is Arabic terms. But actually, people say, okay, so this is because in that time, they also imagine those. They don't have like, they don't know about the chemistry about. So, but God talk about atom and something even less. So here actually what they say is, we have the atom here, and every time the atomic nucleus, they have a neutron and a proton, okay? And each one has this guy, which is called quark. And the good thing, quark is nakir. Nakir is Arabic, is like when they knock, knock. And they actually, they believe, now they figure out that those quark, their motion inside the proton nucleon is kind of, knocking. It's not like the way they move. And each one has a thread. So the long story short, here the message is God will not be injustice as much as this thread. So he will be as just as he can. Ion. We all believe that ion from here. But for some reason, people out of did research, why God said we sent down ion? In the Quran, he would never say we have ion from here, and Zain al-Hadid. We always say we sent down ion. Here's a great force and benefits to the people. Now, the science told us that the abundance in rocky planets like Earth is due to abundant production of fusion in the high-mass stars, where it is the last element to be produced with the release of energy before the supernova, which scatters in the ion to space. So there is supernova, and those scatters, and they move around the space, and they fall down. Now, why is that? He says certain temperature needed for the ion formation. And exist those temperature neither exist in the Earth, nor even in the sun. Even the sun has like 15 million degree core temperature, but they need more. Actually, it's not enough for the ion. It needs about 100 million. So here, 15, it needs 100 degree. Supernova, which exceeds the stars, it can no longer accommodate that and explodes. And when it explodes, the ion will be scattered and go to the Earth and other things. Let's talk about the mountains. I have two more and I'll be done. So mountains, the Quran says, we have set on the earth mountains standing firm, lest it should shift with them, and we made their passes as they guided. Also, he says, we have made the earth resting place. So here the science says, this talking about the mountains' property of preventing shocks on the earth. And the science says that this fact has been exposed as a result of the discoveries of modern geology. They say, actually, even like, for example, Mount of Everest, which is the highest mountain, he says it has 9 kilometers, but actually it has now discovered, but it has about 125 kilometers on the down on the earth. So that's actually made them stand fast. Now look at the Quran. He says, for the another verse about the mountains, he says, you see the mountains, thinking them rigid, you think they are stable? But while they would drift as the drifting of the clouds. Actually, that confuses scientists a lot, even Muslims, why God says this. This is the work of Allah. And now people go back to the science and talk to the Alfred Wegener when he says, this German geologist, he prevailed the continental drift theory in 15 when he simply said, this actually, again, hypothesis, is proposed that parts of the Earth crust slowly drift atop of liquid core. Okay, and then again, he's talking about continental drift. I'm gonna skip this. Now let's talk about zoology. Okay, for the bees, God talked about two things actually, one of the bees and one of the spider. For the bees, it says, "أو حربك النحل أن تخذي." Okay, so God says the Lord inspired the bee female. Okay, build yourself houses among the mountains, among the trees, and when they construct. So now actually the Quran also, they eat from the fruit, and follow the ways of your God. There emerges from the bellies a drink, varying colors, in which there is a healing for people. Now, actually, the science told us that there is a drone, which is male, and there is a worker bee that is a female. And the drone, which is a male, is just a product of, and like the female, drone does not have stingers and don't gather nectar and pollen. A drone's primary role is to mate with the fertile. The worker's female bees does the job, exactly like the Quran says. For the spider, it says, the example of those who take allies other than Allah is like female spider who builds itself home, and indeed the flimsiest of the homes is the home of spider, Awhan al-Buyut. So now it says why God mentioned the female spider net is very flimsy. And let's talk about this. Most of the creature about the science, it says, this actually nice website says, most of the creatures, they build their houses to protect themselves from cold, water, enemies, and blah, blah, blah. Spider is the only way, is the only animal that builds the house to eat. It's like kind of ambush. Maybe not the only one, but have is one of the creatures that have ambushing. So spiders are among the minorities of the living creature in which females are stronger than male. If you see, the females always bigger and larger. Female spiders also eat their males after copulating with it. In the book of, I'm not going to mention this, I'm going to maybe skip because I don't have time. I'm talking last one, which is medicine. I'm going to finish up in 5 minutes. So he actually, there's two stories about medicine, and then I will end up this. He says, he creates in the wombs of your mother, creation after creation, within there the three veils of darkness. That is Allah, the Lord, belongs everything. Now, to the medicine agrees that actually they have like three layers inside the womb, and section of women have 30 weeks. So, and also sometimes they say because it might means the three darkness, three stages, because we have germinal, we have embryonic, we have fetal from the time of conception till about a few weeks, and from weeks to the time of getting birth. So those actual stages, or even the layers, is mentioned in the Quran. The other way, which is the it's most maybe difficult verse in the Quran about this, is talking about then we made the sperm drop into a clinging clot, and we made the clot into lamb flesh. We made from the lamb bones. We covered the bones with the flesh. We developed him into another creation, plus is the God. So here, again, the other way says, if you don't believe in resurrection, then consider this example. The example is, we created you from the dust, sperm drop, clean clot, lamb of flesh, formed and unformed, and then we settled the womb's specified terms. So here actually, if you see, then we bring you as a child, and then we die, blah, blah, blah. So here actually, if you see the sequence, is mentioned exactly at the conception, embryo, until the fetus. If you see, the six stages actually is mentioned here. I'm gonna focus on this because actually that's the word. It's called alaka. It's kind of nice word. It's kind of the people try to translate what God means by this. And one of the websites they try to translate this word and they found out it had three meanings: meaning of the leech, meaning of suspended. And if you Google, you also find those three words and blood clot. And now Professor Keith Moore in his website, and actually his book, Before We Are Born, okay, that edition, it says, by the end of the third week, the heart of the embryo connects with its blood and forms the cardiovascular system. It is during this period when the heart begins to beat and blah, 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 so that's okay, and moves around the embryo. So he's talking about this period, it's like a blood clot. And also suspended because we have the connecting stalk, and also, Barry Mitchell, this actual embryology book, is mentioned this, that the connecting stalk is formed, so it's hanging. And even like in this book, Fundamentals of Human Embryology, is talking about this stalk is kind of suspending, so it's almost the same word. Now, this word, last word, has been remembrance becomes a yolk, and by 24 is the connecting stalk. It's again talking about stalk. Now, the last word is leech. Now, they compare why this guy is almost the same size of leech, why God mentioned this a leech. And they took some, I don't know if this is X-ray or, they took the internal anatomical structure of the leech, and this is with the embryo, and actually they found like it's almost identical. And even the head of the embryo, 22 days, and the head of the leech is almost the same. I'm gonna skip this for timing. This is for the, I'm gonna also skip math, because we have no time, but again, so we talked about two things actually. The first part is everything I mentioned, the practices Muslim believe from the Bible, and the next one we talked about the science. Some of the things we agree with the Bible, some of them they part ways, but the take-home message actually, what I believe, and maybe some of you disbelieve or disagree with me, we believe that God is one, and all them prophets, and those actually, both of them are really good book of God's. Now, the only difference is Bible is the Old and New Testament, and some people call the Quran as the New Testament. Thank you so much for your time, and I really appreciate it.